Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Lord, we love you today. Lord, we thank you today that we're able to come into the house of the Lord and give you praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise, God. Lord, we thank you, Lord God, for another day, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for traveling grace. We thank you, Lord, that you woke us up this morning, that you gave us our right mind or a reasonable part of our health and strength, Lord God. So we come in today just saying thank you. If it had not been for you, thou art sad, I don't know where we would be. So we say thank you, God. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We shall enter into his gates with thanksgiving, enter into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his holy name, for he is good. Hallelujah. His mercy is everlasting. Hallelujah. I get joy when I think about what he's done for me. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Come on, we can run through the songs and just begin to exalt his holy name. Because he's worthy, he's mighty, he's great, he's excellent, and he's able, and he's willing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. So we just come today saying thank you. Thank you. We praise you in every situation. Whether we on top or whether we on the bottom, Lord God, I'd rather be there with you. So we glorify your holy and your righteous name. We want to welcome our Facebook family. We want to welcome our in-person family just for being in the house of the Lord today, for joining us on live. We say welcome. God, it's a privilege. It's an honor. Somebody wanted to be here that couldn't. Somebody couldn't even get out of the bed this morning. Someone's laying in the hospital. Someone's locked up in the jail. They wanted to be here. So we should be grateful that we're able to come into the house of the Lord. Grateful. Hallelujah. So I just give him glory. I just give him honor. I just give him praise. I just thank him for who he is. Thank you, God. Come on, our scripture today is going to be coming from Proverbs 3. And we're going to start at verse 5. And this is a very familiar passage. So I'm going to ask y'all if y'all can read along with me. Amen. Come on, we're going to do something a little different. We're going to read together today. Because in the times that we're in, we need to read this scripture. Because sometimes we want to go our own way and do what God ain't telling us to do. But we got to trust him. We can't lead until our own understanding. And in all ways, we need to acknowledge him. Amen. So Proverbs 3. And I'm reading from the King James Version. Starting at verse 5. Here we go. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Amen. Trust in the Lord. Don't lean unto your own understanding. Acknowledge him, and he will direct our path. If we just trust him, even if we don't understand it, we can't lean onto our own understanding. We got to lean to his understanding. We got to have faith in him. That's what we learned in our ministers meeting, right? Faith. We got to have faith. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So trust in the Lord during this situation. Trust in the Lord. Hallelujah. I read Proverbs 3, 5 through 6, and the word of the Lord is already blessed. Amen. Us like Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to ask y'all if y'all could help us out a little bit. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. I said, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Do me like Jesus. Well, cause he's my friend.
Can't nobody
do me like Jesus.
Do me like Jesus.
I said, can't nobody do me Lord.
Do me like the Lord.
I say, can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Do me like Jesus.
Well, 'cause he's my friend. He healed my body. Told me to run on.
Healed my body.
Told me to run on.
Told me to run on.
Well, he healed my body.
Told me to run
on. Told me to run on. Yes, 'cause he's my friend. I said, can't nobody do me like Jesus.
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 Heal my body, told me to run on.
Heal my body and told me to run on.
Heal my body, told me to run on.
Heal my body and told me to run on.
Nobody.
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 No, 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 no,
no.
No, 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 no.
No, 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 no.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
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 Can't nobody hold me like Jesus.
Can't nobody hold me
like Jesus. Can't nobody hold me like Jesus.
Ain't nobody hold me
well,
like Jesus.
Nobody.
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 Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
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 'Cause he's my friend. Yeah, yeah. He's my friend.
Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. How many know can't nobody do us like Jesus? Come on, how many know he's our friend? He's our friend in the midnight hour. He's our friend when everybody else done turned their back. He's our friend, and can't nobody do us like Jesus. Amen. That's why we got to trust him. That's why we got to lean not into our own understanding. That's why we got to acknowledge him, and he will direct our path, because can't nobody do us like Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, don't let the worship stop there. Hallelujah. Can't nobody do you like Jesus, because he is my friend. Ain't it good to be a friend of God? Ain't it be good? Ain't it good to be a friend of someone who has your best interest at heart at all times? Can't nobody do us like Jesus. I'd like to say good evening. Welcome to everyone. It's good to see your beautiful faces. We honor the Lord today for your presence in person, as well as our live stream family. We honor the Lord for our virtual church. Come on, y'all, let's give them a hand. Amen. We thank God for those that are tuned in. We want to say thank you. We welcome you. We know you had a lot of options, and we thank you for choosing us. We ask that you would not only go down and press the share button, but during the service, if a word touch you, amen, give us some like emojis, some love emojis, some worshiping hands, amen. Give us something to let us know you're enjoying what God is doing in this place tonight. Once again, welcome, y'all. It's good to see y'all. We honor the Lord for your presence on tonight. I'm excited about this new series we're about to jump into. Amen. Jump. We're about to jump into something, y'all. And we pray that it's going to bless bless our spirit, amen. And I'm gonna stay there until the Lord says different. But the whole Bible is based around this one thing. We started it last night in our ministers' meeting. It's the theme of faith. Somebody say faith. Yeah, we know the scripture, don't we? Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So we're going to talk about faith. Come on, let's bow our heads right quick. Let's go to God in prayer. Dear gracious God, our Father, thank you, oh God, once again for this time, this opportunity to come in your presence, oh God, seeking to become more like you. Strengthen us, hold us, mold us. Deliver us, oh God, from those snares, those things that want to bog us down and keep our attention off of things that's not like you. You've given us purpose. You've given us power because you've allowed us in your presence. So here we are, oh God. Speak now. Your servants are listening. We're attentive to your every word. Strengthen us that we may not only become strengthened for ourselves, but that wherever life takes us, we'll be strength and light over there. So we thank you for this time. Thank you for this privilege. We thank you for this time. Have your way in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. You're going to need your Bible tonight. Amen. And I want you to go to one particular place and hang out there for a little while. And that's Numbers, the book of Numbers, the 13th chapter. The book of Numbers, the 13th chapter. But I kind of want to jump around a little bit so y'all permit me to establish the context. Amen. So y'all can understand the content. So when you get Numbers 13, you just post up and hang out right there. But let me show you some different things that we're studying in our ministers' meeting. And we found out about faith. Faith has a lot of aspects to it. We know Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But I promise you, faith goes so much deeper. Faith is defined its foundation as the belief in or having confidence or trust, total trust in God. That belief that we have, that faith that we have, should be evident in the life of every disciple of Christ. Disciple is important in that particular sentence because disciple means learner, which means we all have understood or we're understanding that when we engage with Christ, we was on a lifelong mission. There is no completing this class. As long as God wakes you up on this side of the shallow river, there's more for us to learn. In other words, there should be an obvious commitment to God and his will for your life. We gotta work ourselves into understanding that God's will is the center, not the church. His will, his purpose for your life, and the rest of your life is to evolve or revolve around the will that God has for your life. So, and because we don't totally know that, and when we do learn what it is, we still have more learning so we can become good at or perfect what Christ has called in each and every one of us. Real faith, y'all, is the child of the knowledge of God's word. And how does children grow? You feed them. Your child, you will get locked up if you neglect your child and you stymie their growth. Once it becomes noticeable, somebody that cares will call the people on you. So your child needs to be fed in order for them to mature or become who we want or who God wants them to be. So that's just like faith. Faith is the child of the knowledge of God's word. You can't trust in the Lord without trusting in his word. But it's difficult to trust a stranger. A lot of times the reason people don't trust God is because they don't truly know God. They've heard of him. They know what grandmama and them said about him. They have an inkling of him. Listen, y'all, our God is so multidimensional that we could spend the rest of our life learning about him and still won't scratch the surface of who he is. So it's advantageous for us. It's beneficial for us that we continue learning about God, being intimate with God, spending time, spending days, spending intimate moments learning about God. Because when it comes to faith, it's not about quantity, it's about
quality. The Bible says, Romans 12 and 3, he has given every man the measure of faith. And y'all know that scripture we like to quote. Well, I got the faith the size of a mustard seed. God said, that's good. That's the starting point. But even a seed, if it's properly watered and planted correctly, it ain't got no more sense but to grow. So when it comes to faith, it ain't about quantity. It ain't about how much you got. It's about the quality of what you have. Because what you have is what you believe God is able to do. So to develop your faith, you must start by making the decision that God's word is true and you will believe his word above anything else. Now here's where it gets tricky, y'all, because when you begin to live by faith and you begin to walk faith and talk faith and believe faith, to the world you're going to look weird. Because you're going to be speaking things that they can't see that is manifesting and coming your way, but you begin to speak things that you expect from God, and you're only, I'm not talking about manipulating God to give you something that you ain't got no business having. I'm talking about reminding God of his word, because that's what prayer is us having a communication. In order to get on the wavelength with God, we got to say to him what he said to us, and that's why his word can't be a stranger. You have to know what God said about raising kids. You got to know what God said about living in a world that's full of sin. Listen, it got so bad in Noah's day, God said, I got to get rid of everything. Come on, it got so bad, God said, I got to get rid of everything. He found one man in his 8-member church, and everything else got wiped out. So don't think we're living in the worst times ever. But we still serve a God who says, I know what's going on. I got word to help you navigate what's going on, but you got to familiarize yourself with what I've already said. Ain't no new Bible coming out. Ain't no new theology coming out. Ain't no new doctrine coming out. He's already said what he's going to say, and he's so powerful. What he said is still relevant today, and it will be relevant for why? Grandmama and them said, he's the same yesterday, today. That's why you can take confidence in teaching your babies and grandbabies about this same God, because when they get old enough to understand, he gonna be the same that he was. He's not. There's no shadow of changing. So a couple of faith. We're just gonna deal with a couple, because I want to show you this story and hopefully we can get our way through it. I want to show you something that we dealt with last night, and it's just two aspects of faith. The first one we dealt with was called doctrinal faith. Somebody say doctrinal. Yeah, big old $5 word. Doctrinal faith is this: faith based on believing the word of God and the teaching of the Bible. So doctrinal faith says, I believe the word of God and I believe the teaching that's housed in the Bible, okay? But you got to go one further, because doctrinal faith is the teaching and the belief, but there's another level to which God wants us to ascend to as Christians, and that's called scriptural faith. Scriptural faith, a faith that believes with the heart in spite of what the physical senses or circumstances may say. Yeah, you're starting to grow up in that faith when you can start just not believing with your mind, but you start believing in your heart. Watch this. John Wesley said this, y'all: the devil has given the church a substitute for faith, and it's called mental assent. It's mental assent. Watch this. Many people will agree that the Bible is true, but they are agreeing with their minds. It takes heart to receive this kind of faith from God. So what is he saying? He's saying doctrinal faith is getting it in your mind. Because you know where we come from, to get stuff in our mind is a challenge. Okay, y'all been saved all y'all life. As raggedy as my life was before I met God and before I got serious, because even after I met him, I didn't get serious. But once I got serious, I had to deprogram myself so that I could reprogram myself, and I had to do it with the word of God. I couldn't do it. I was in the choir all my life. It wasn't doing it for me. I was coming to church since I was a boy. It wasn't doing it for me. It wasn't until I got serious with God that I began to see things different, because I had a desire not to just have doctrinal faith, but to have scriptural faith. Proverbs 23 and 7 says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he, so is she. As he thinketh, listen to how it connects it, in his heart. So the proverb, the greatest, they said he was the wisest king ever, Solomon, is saying you can't just think faith. Faith has got to get down in your heart. Because anybody knows once it gets in your heart, that's how it gets in your bloodstream. Yeah, that's how it matriculates and goes to the places it's needed the most. All right? So if God's word says it's true, then it's true. It's mine. I have it now. And if I have it now, even though I can't see it, I know God cannot lie. And that's when it becomes heart faith. That means there's going to be seasons where my eyesight is going to let me down. And if I don't have the proper faith in my heart, then my decisions are going to be made off of what I can see and not what I know. I know what God said about this situation. I know what God said he can do. We believe God can do it for others. We got to get to the point where we believe God can do it for us. And how do we get there? You got to rehearse what God said about your situation. You got to know what the word of God said. Because listen, tonight's topic is called faith in the majority. Okay, I know it's the scenic rap, but watch this. Numbers. Numbers 13. Y'all got Numbers 13? Numbers 13 and 1 starts off like this. NIV version. The Lord said to Moses, send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I'm giving to the Israelites. From each ancestral tribe, send one of its leaders. So at the Lord's command, Moses sent them out from the desert of Paran. All of them were leaders of Israelites. And then it begins to go in their names. Well, watch. At this time, the children of Israel had been released. They had been delivered. They had been pulled out of bondage from Egyptian slavery. Remember, they was in Egypt. Moses, they cried out. God sent Moses to deliver them. Moses led them out. Now they're going through wilderness. They're having lack. They not don't have enough food. They don't have enough to eat. Everything they struggle with, God sends an answer. So God has shown that he's with him. Listen, they said they was on Mount Sinai. All this takes place on Mount Sinai. You got to start at Exodus and then go down through Leviticus and Deuteronomy and Numbers and find out the whole totality of the story. But they find themselves on Mount Sinai. Remember, they already have the law that was in Exodus. God has already established he's for them. That was in Exodus. God has given them laws that they must do because God is getting ready to do something that he told their forefathers. He said, I'm going to take you into the land that's flowing with milk and honey. The Bible says they made this tent of meeting or this tabernacle. This is the place that Moses went where he dwelt with God. Remember, they didn't have a Bible like you and I. Moses was their Bible. So whatever Moses said, Moses got from God, and God couldn't fathom in his mind that they could hear from Moses and not believe in what he said. So here they are. They're on the precipice of having to go in the promised land. I'm telling you, y'all, you got to learn how to have faith of the majority. Watch the text. They're in the precipice. They're in Mount Sinai. They're about to go in, and God gives them a strategy. God told Moses, send some men in because I want y'all to see what I'm talking about. Go down to verse 25 because he sends them in. He tells them what to look for. He tells them what to do. He gives them a strategy. And by the time you get to verse 25, it says, at the end of 40 days, somebody say 40 days, they return from exploring the land. Now, I told you, God has already gave them the promise. God has already gave them the command. God has gave them the strategy. God said, listen, I know what I'm doing, but since y'all are prone not to believe me, I want y'all to take one from each tribe. Why? Because I don't want the Danites not listening to the Levites, because the Levite leader ain't the Danite leader. He said, so I want one from Dan. I want one from Zebulun. I want one from Judah. I want one from Issachar. I want one from Asher. I want one from Zebulun. I want one from Judah. He wanted one from each tribe so that he could kill that rap about them giving them a false report. Them into the land flowing with milk and honey. They brought back big old ripe grapes and pomegranates, and the Bible says for 40 days they witnessed what God had told them through Moses. These are the leaders. These are the leaders. They over there and they witnessing everything. The Bible says they come back, verse 25, at the end of 40 days they return. Watch this. And they came back to Moses and Aaron. And the whole Israelite community at Kadesh in the desert of Paran, there they reported to them, to the whole assembly, and showed them the fruit of the land. Somebody say the evidence. Yeah, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things. Not God said, it's your land. Your people have went in there. They've done a reconnaissance. They bought back this evidence to show y'all I'm God and I got y'all. But watch the text, because now the 12 that was caucused together in faith in the land of Canaan has now gotten back in front of their people. Watch 27. It says they gave Moses this account. Remember, they get back in front of the assembly. They got evidence. But watch when they open their mouth. We went in to the land of which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Here's the evidence. Here's the fruit. But the people who live are powerful. Cities are fortified, very large. All of this is true. We saw even the descendants of Anak. Now, the descendants of Anak was giants. They was big fellows. So they was like, man, we went in there. Here's the fruit. Here's the evidence that God's word is true. And listen, child of God, whenever you walk by faith, you will always have people who naysay and they go the opposite of what you're experiencing. You have to have the faith of the majority that says no matter how many of them it is, it's me and God. I'll be glad when we get strong enough not to need people around us to help us be strong, but that we have enough confidence in the word that says, I don't care how many people says no, I heard yes. And when I heard yes, I'm in the faith. My faith is of the majority, because the Bible says if God be for us, who? So it don't matter how many of them it is, I heard God. And I have to have enough faith, enough confidence in what I heard from God to stand on it, even when it's not popular, even when nobody's going, you go on, I'm going on, because I heard what God said. And sometimes you got to walk away from stuff and people to let them know I'm serious about what I heard from God. Watch. Here the fruit, milk, honey. They gave Moses the account. They said, but look, man, look, them men, people big. Cities fortified, very large. We even saw the descendants of Anak, the Amalekites living in Negev, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites. They live in the hill country. The Canaanites live near the sea and all along the Jordan. And then Caleb says, enough. Verse 30, the Bible says, Caleb quieted, stilled the noise. Because whenever God has given you a word, he's given you evidence that the word is true. And then you top it off with the fact God said it. There's no time to discuss. See, because what happened to the other 10, because Caleb and Joshua was in the favor of the minority, what happened to the other 10 is they began to start trying to do what God ain't told them to do. And oftentimes that's the challenge of our faith, is that God tells us something, and we so educated, we gonna come up with our own strategy. God said, listen, I didn't tell you to find out how you gonna whoop the Anak. I didn't tell you to find out how you're going to whoop the Jebusites or the Hittites or the Canaanites or the Amorites, the Amalekites or the Shadites. Whoever's over there, God said, I didn't tell you to start trying to figure out how you're going to do. All I told you to do is go see. Faith is simple, y'all. God is saying, trust me enough that you believe me over what you see. And that's the hardest thing, ain't it, sometimes? For you to sit in the doctor and listen to all them reports, and they got all this stuff hooked up and all these numbers and stuff flying around, and you don't know what's going on. But you heard God. Bruised. My iniquities. Wounded. For my transgression. By his stripes. I know I'm hooked up to every IV you can. By his stripes. I'm healed. The manifestation ain't came yet, but I'm not going to give in to the minority opinion, because I got majority faith and I trust God because I've heard him. Caleb said, shh, for Moses. He said, we should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it. Why is Caleb so confident? Because God said it. You got to get it in your spirit, child of God. I'm going to be redundant on these topics, but you got to get it in your spirit. When God says it, it's so. You ain't got to figure out how. I don't even care how. God said go, all right, I'm going. I might have to look silly. I might have to walk. Come on. The blind man in John chapter 9, when that Jesus spit in the mud and wiped it on that man's eyes, he said, now go wash your eyes in the pool of Siloam. That man ain't never seen that place. But guess what he started doing? Blind as all get out. Been born blind. He didn't get blind. So he never knew where that place was. But he had enough crazy faith to say, listen, they gonna laugh. They laugh. He walking through the village with mud on his eyes. Blind dude, where that fool going? He looks silly. Look at him, y'all. They laughing. And Chuck, he went down and washed his eyes. He came back and they hurried up and took him to the authority. They said, man, he said, listen, it was a man named Jesus. And when you got the kind of radical major faith that you need, sometime you're going to look silly. Yeah, people going to laugh when you're building a boat and it ain't never rained. They steady sinning, having a good time, turning up. They throwing rocks at the boat, laughing at Noah. You're spending all your money on wood. You're spending all your time building that boat. And Noah got the same sermon for 120 years. And guess what? One day, you know how silly Noah looked building the boat in a desert and they never seen rain? Oh, but when it started raining, what was they doing? No, he said, I ain't got the key, bro. I can't let you in if I wanted to. Because sometimes you got to show God, listen, I'm willing to put myself in uncomfortable situations. And though I may not look like, no, listen, you may not have been born in a family of faith, but God may be trying to birth a family of faith through you. You may be the one that turned your family around, turn your generation around. Okay, you didn't go to church your whole life. Start now and make the people up under you follow you. That's faith. That's what God wants. God wants you to know I can do anything but fail. But what do? We read God the impossible report. The annex was over. They big. Caleb said, shh. We should go up and take it immediately. For we certainly, Lord, I love Caleb, we certainly can do it. But the men who had gone up with him, because remember, Caleb was one of the leaders. He was the one leading his tribe. But the men said, we can't attack those people. They stronger than we are. You're right. You can't attack them. And you are weak. But listen, you're not going in your own power. When you're obedient, listen, you'll get some supernatural stuff that don't belong to you, which means you can't take no credit for it. And after you get the victory, don't you break your arm, patting yourself on the back. You turn around and say, if it had not been. Come on, some of us got testimonies. We know as smart as we are, as much money as we got, as connected as we are, as slick as we are, if it had not been for God, that wouldn't have happened. So you got to understand this, but it's a faith thing. It's a trust thing. It's a belief that God can do it in spite of these men had gone up with him. They said, man, we can't attack them. People that are stronger than us. And watch this. And they spread amongst the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. I told you why lies traveled quicker than the truth, because they ain't got long to live. Negativity was always spread first. Come on, positive don't spread. Positive got to sit there and hope he's been acknowledged. But negative, be around the city in 1 hour. Watch, so the negative spread it. Bad report. They said, the land we explored devours those living in it. Now they done changed it. Look how they done flipped it. Now it devours the, all God said was go look at it so that you can see that I'm telling you the truth. Bring back some of them big old grapes and them pomegranates so you can show these people that I know what I'm talking about. And because I'm God, watch this. And remember, I delivered y'all from Egypt. Did y'all forget at the Yom Suf when I made that at Red Sea turn into a highway? Y'all done forgot about that. Did y'all remember when there wasn't no water nowhere to be found and I told Moses to smack a rock and y'all started drinking? Y'all forgot about that. Do y'all remember when y'all wanted to go back and eat and I started making manna fall from heaven and you got to eat as much as you want? Do y'all remember that? It's oftentimes we forget how good God has been because the new challenge is what we can see. But the evidence is in what he's done before. And if he did it before, he'll do it again. But it starts, how do we believe? And listen, the evidence is how you walk. It ain't got nothing to do with how you talk. Because look, Caleb ain't talking. Caleb like, come on. We can go do, we ain't stand here doing all this talking. Caleb like, come on, we certainly can go up. But they started. How the land explores devours those living in it. All the people we saw, they are great inside. We saw the Nephilim. They were descendants of Anak, came from Nephilim. We seem like, watch this, because whenever you start talking negative, you begin to see yourself in a negative light. Watch, they said, we seem like grasshoppers in our own eyes. And we certainly, we look like the same thing Who called you a grasshopper? You got God on your side. God has led you to this point. God is in the tent. You see Moses in the tent every morning. What do you think he's in there doing? He's in there getting instruction from God. We on a mission. We got purpose. But in order to move forward, it's going to take faith. Come on, turn the page. Next one, 14. No, number 14. We still in here. That night, all the members of the community raised their voices and wept. Now, not only do you not want to go, not only have you contaminated everybody else with this foolishness, then you're gonna start crying and weeping aloud. And listen, y'all, they hadn't even moved. They hadn't even tried to see. I'd have felt a lot better about them if they would have tried and it failed. But they considered themselves failure long before. And how many times, Lord have mercy, have we just not even tried? God, it ain't going to work. It didn't work for Big Mama them. It ain't going to work. You see what they tried down the street? It's not going to work. And we don't even give God a chance to show us the miraculous. They cried. The members cried. Of the community raised their voices, wept all night. All the Israelites, look at this, grumbled against the leadership, against Moses and Aaron. And the whole assembly said to them, if we only had died in Egypt, or at least in the wilderness, why is the Lord bringing us to this land? Only to let us fall by the sword. Our wives and children will be taking this plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should choose one of these crash dummies and go on back to Egypt. That's what it should have been. Tell me, we should choose a leader. Now, a leader ain't talking about going back to Egypt. Because y'all know what was going down in Egypt. They took your straw and told you to make bricks at the same quota that you made them before they took the straw. It's no fun in Egypt. But when we get delivered, it always looks more fun back where we. I'm talking about once we get bought out and we face an opportunity to stretch our faith that's uncomfortable. I was making more money when I was in the streets. Yeah, and your life was on the line every minute of the day. But God done delivered you. And now you're delivered. I had more fun when I was in the world. Yeah, but kids know you can't party every day. Eventually the party gonna have to stop. But when God brings us out, it's like what we got brought out from looks better. Come on, you look across the street and see they don't go to church. Ain't been to Bible study. Can't spell Bible. If they got cars in the driveway, rims, they kids always got on fresh clothes. You trying to figure out, and I'm over here struggling, loving the Lord. And I'm watching these people in my neighborhood. Look like they don't know Jesus because they cutting their grass on Sunday morning. On the roof, putting up flowers, doing all this stuff. I'm rushing, trying to get the Bible study, trying to get to church. And these people are just living their best life. And I'm stressed out, trying to get a word, trying to go to work, trying to do this, trying to go to school. And I got all this stuff going on. And other folks look like they living better. It looks better. I just going back to Egypt. The devil is a lie. Because if God had a return when you was in Egypt. So they're looking to choose a leader to take them back to Egypt. And then Moses and Aaron, watch this. We almost done, y'all, promise you. Moses and Aaron fell down. They faced down in front of the whole assembly. Joshua, son of Nun. Caleb, remember them names, son of Jephunneh. Who were among those who explored the land, they tore their clothes. Because remember, it's a sign of grieving. It's a sign of anguish. Because Joshua and Caleb was with the other 10. And they seen what God can do. They heard what God said. And they know what God can do if they would just move from there. They said to the entire Israelite assembly, the land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us. We got one job, verse 9. Joshua and Caleb said, listen, y'all, we got one job. Only do not rebel against the Lord. And let me help you, y'all, because you know half obedience is still disobedience. And oftentimes we do half of what God said. I mean, that's good enough. That's the best I got. You're still disobedient. Do not be afraid of the people of the land. because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not. Did y'all hear what he said? He said their protection is gone. Remember, the walls was fortified. The walls was big. The people was big. It was walled in according to Numbers 13 and 1. But Joshua said, their protection is gone. But the Lord is with. I told you, when you have faith for the majority, you don't allow oppositions to become oppositions. You see them, you assess them, and then you trust God. You just listen for the strategy. Fast forward, 40 years later, because Joshua and Caleb had the faith. When you get to Numbers 14 and 24, the Bible says that Caleb had a different spirit. In other words, Caleb held on to what God said more than what the people were saying. And watch, God got mad at him. Watch, the whole assembly talked about stoning them. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all the Israelites. The Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the signs I perform among them? I will strike them down with a plague and destroy them, but I will make you into a greater and stronger. Make you into a nation greater and stronger than that. Then Moses and God start going back and forth. Moses was like, man, you can't do that. The people going to hear about how you bought us out and killed us. He said, come on, God, you can't reconsider that. You can't do that. And the Bible says, God said, all right. You got to read it when you get home. God said, all right, I am. He said, but they ain't going. God said, I ain't going to kill them, but I'm going to strike them with this plague because what they have will hinder what Caleb and Joshua have if I let it hang out forever. That's why when you got faith, it's difficult to hang out with people who don't have it. Because eventually, come on, when we think, come on, we think more highly of ourselves than we all sometimes, don't we? We think, I'm going to influence them before they influence me. And you still ain't got them come to church, but they got you missing every time they mention. So we got to be careful. And listen, we ain't cutting people off. I don't fool with them no more. Now I'm getting myself together so that if I do fool with them, it won't cost me what I know to be true. So fast forward, 400 years, 40 years. God is finally ready to allow them to enter in. Can I give you one more verse? I'm through, I promise. Joshua. I just want y'all to see this, y'all. This all came and it's too much to give to y'all tonight, but we're going to work. Joshua 2, verse 8. Now remember, it's 40 years later, the 10 and the people they influenced, God didn't let them go to the promised land. At this point in the biblical narrative, Moses has died because Moses was disobedient. God told him to strike the rock the first time for the water, he struck it. The second time, God told him, speak to the rock. But Moses was in righteous indignation. He was mad. He struck the rock and it disobeyed God. And God said, you know what? Go up there. He wouldn't let him go to Mount Nebo. He said, look, that's the land I told you about. But you ain't going, Mo. Because God also knew Moses wasn't a fighter. But Joshua was. Remember, he said, the land is flowing with milk and honey. But that don't mean I'm just going to give it to you. And oftentimes we think faith means, go ahead, God. I'm just going to sit back and wait on God. Wait on God. God said, Listen, it's a land flowing with milk and honey. It's a promised land, but it's not a virgin land. So that means this there's stuff for now, but I'm going to bless you because you're going to become the nation that I want to birth my Messiah from. So I'm going to allow you to take what belongs to you. You just got some other people on it right now. The Bible says 40 years went by, 40 years went by. All the people, you remember they was in the wilderness? The Bible says they walked and walked and their shoes never wore out. They clothes didn't give in. Look, the more they grew, the more their clothes grew. I'm talking about a supernatural God. He blessed them. He took care of them, y'all. And listen, Caleb and Joshua, they didn't get to sit in the tent while everybody else walked in the wilderness. Their faith didn't make them not have to go through what it took to get the next generation to the level that God wanted them to be. So even though they was faithful, there still was some struggle for them. They was faithful. There still was some pain for them. But their faith allowed them to go through it because they knew what God had said. Fast forward, the Bible says, now you got two spies. They in the land of Canaan. And they've sent two spies in this time because Joshua was a little smarter than Moses. Moses sent in 12. Joshua said that was too many. I'm just going to send in two. And he sent the two in. Remember, they was at Rahab's house. And the people was looking for them. And Rahab lied. Rahab said, they gone out the city gate, but she had put them on the roof of her house. Remember Rahab, don't you? Rahab was a prostitute. To, which means God can save anybody. Rahab had a reputation of laying and playing, but because she was ready to change, her reputation hadn't yet changed, but she had an encounter with God. The Bible says the men, the spies, verse 8, before the spies lay down for the night, after she done sent the people looking for them, she knew the spies was on the roof. Before the spies lay down that night, she went up on the roof. Listen to her conversation. Her testimony is so powerful. She said to them, I know that the Lord has given you this land, and that a great fear of you has fallen on us, so that all who live in this country are melting in fear because of you. They shall X out you and put because of God. Could it be 40 years ago, God had already planted this seed in Canaan, and they was trembling in fear, knowing that they might be able to whoop Israel, but they couldn't whoop Israel's God. And Rahab shows us right here that the Lord has sent fear through. That's what I'm telling y'all. When you have faith, don't look at how it looks. Don't look at how you're outnumbered. Don't look at what you up against. Just remember what God said to you, and I promise you, he gonna take you through. It may hurt. You may have to cry a little bit. You may have to fight a little bit, but you trust God, and don't you give up on what he said. I don't care who walked out of your life. I don't care who give up on you. I don't care who says you bag yourself. You trust God, and you allow God to grow and strengthen your faith. Remember, a child of faith is from the knowledge of God. That's how we grow, in the word of God, not by what we see, not by what they say, not by insurmountable odds, but I simply trust God. And as a result, my faith is in the majority. I know I'm outnumbered. I know it's more of them than us, but my faith is in God. Why? Because I'm not fighting this fight in my own strength. You're right. I can't whoop Anak. I can't whoop Nephilim. I can't whoop the Amorite. I can't whoop nobody, but I can trust God, and I let God give me the strategy. And if he tells me to walk up to a fence and start hollering, I may look crazy, but I know he gonna give me deliverance. And the walls of Jericho came tumbling. They didn't shoot a dart. They didn't start a fight. They didn't even say nothing to them people. They just simply followed the plan of God, and they walked around, and them people probably like, look at these fools. I should shoot them right now. God was so covering them. The people on the things with the bows couldn't even shoot the Israelite army. And when they began to shout, the walls came tumbling down. But guess what wall didn't fall? The one with Rahab's house in it. Y'all better listen to God. You better believe God. How can all the walls fall but the one? Go on, read the story. And listen, when the walls are falling, they sent the command. They said, man, go tell Rahab, get her people, come on out. And now Rahab goes down in the hall of faith. She's in the line, the lineage pattern of the Messiah, Jesus Christ. She started out a thought. Now she's an intercessor. And listen, I love Rahab. I ain't gonna mess with her, but listen, Rahab's story is so powerful because they told her, go get your people and everybody in your family and make sure they're in your house at the moment. So Rahab had to have some forgiveness, didn't she? Because you know how they talked about Rahab before she got converted. I'll teach y'all that one on another Sunday. But listen, faith of the majority, I don't care how many, it was two of them. 10, and they got thousands. Remember, it was 2 million people when they came out of Egypt. Can you imagine how many people sided with those that said, we can't? 2 million people. And y'all worried about how many? We deep, super deep, and we got God. And all they could do is rehearse. Question as we close Bible study. How much rehearsing do you do of the problem? And does it equal out greater than, less than of the rehearsing that you do of what God said? Because when you spend more time, that's it, indwelling faith, in the presence of God, understanding that he didn't bring me this far for nothing. Come on, I got friends that's been killed. I got people in my life that's died. I got classmates that are dying every day. Lord, you got me here for a reason. And I'm determined. Come on, if he didn't get me when I was over there, I refused to come over here and let him get me. No, you had your shot, bro. The Bible says demons fear at the name. And he's given us the authority to speak the name. And we still scared of them. Oh, no, them demons, you got the power in your mouth. Speak to them and you can walk right through them. I walk through the valleys. Shadows of death. I don't fear no evil. Whack. You know who with me? I know you can't see him, but you can't put your hands on me. Come on, I serve the kind of God that allowed you to be in places you ain't got no business being, and everything that happened to everybody else, and you walk out and be like, how come you didn't get hit? Huh? Trust God. Believe. It can't just stay doctrinal. It has to become scriptural. And when it gets in your heart, see, some stuff I know. I know my name is Yusef Chandler Westbrook. You can call me everything you want to call me. And I'm in no way obligated to answer because I know that's not my name. That's how faith has to be. I know I'm a child of God. I know he's got something for my life. So therefore, you can slide all of these hookups and all of this stuff you want in my face to try to get me distracted. But I know what my daddy said. And greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Come on, let's go to God in prayer over here. If you've been helped, give God some praise. Hallelujah. Majority faith. If God be for us, y'all, he's more than the whole world against us. And listen, the world knows that. Do we? Every head bowed, every eye closed. Thank you, oh God, once again. Your grace, your mercy, God, you've been better to us than we could ever be to ourselves. We thanking you tonight, God. We're grateful because you've been so faithful, even when we haven't. Yet you still find a way to love us, forgive us, give us what we need and not what we deserve. So we thank you tonight, God. Help us to graduate from doctrinal faith to scriptural faith, that it will get in our heart. We'll begin to see things from a faith perspective. We know it can be lonely, God. We know it's sometimes going to cause us to look different. That's why you called us a peculiar people. So we thank you. We claim in it. We want to experience it right now in Jesus' name. Have your way in our life. Amen and amen. Come on, y'all. Doors of the church is open. Let's stand. I know all members are here, but we want to welcome in anyone that may come via live stream. We want you to know that here at God's will, we want what's best for your life. We love you, but we would love to see you develop for Christ. It just takes one small step. If you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that he was raised from the dead, you too can experience this eternal salvation that we all are yearning to experience. If that's you tonight, get us your information, whether it's in the comments, whether you want to call the church, leave a message, whether you want to email us. So there's all kind of ways that you can get in contact with us, and we'll be more than happy to help you develop as the man or woman of God that he's called you to be. Today can be the best day to the rest of your life if you would just trust God and allow him to lead you into your future. Come on, we're going to give you about 30 seconds to think about it. Offer the opportunity. If that's you, come on, trust God.
Things that he brought me through. I've kept bottled up inside, trying my best to be strong, waiting on God and holding on.
Don't know, my God, amen. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise. If you come via live stream, we will get your information and we'll be in contact with you as soon as possible. Don't forget, if you'd like to partner with us, whether you're live or in person, you'd like to partner with us in helping us support the gospel, we offer opportunities for you to give our Cash App, give LaFay, or our snail mail. We thank you for each and every person that continues to be a blessing. Even in the pandemic, God has been more than generous to us, and we're grateful. And I'm for sure that if you've been faithful, He sure enough has been faithful. So we want to thank you, ask you to continue to give, building fund to our missions and mercy, to all of the different things that we have going on here in God's Will. Thank you, God's Will's members, for continuing to sow into our ministry. We have more work we want to do, amen. So we need your support, and we need you to continue, amen, to give as God has blessed you. Don't forget as well, this Friday. Okay, let's do the prayer then. Amen. Every Tuesday, 8 o'clock is our prayer. Amen. Don't forget, we have a new number. Get the information. You should be receiving the text. If you're not receiving the group church text, please see Deacon Singletary. Amen. He can get you so that you can get a notification. Sometimes the notification is what wakes some of us up. Amen. So don't forget to get with him if you're not getting those text information. Don't forget our intercessory prayer every Wednesday and Sunday, 1 hour before our services. Remember, ma'am, remember, sir, if conversation is needed to be had, we understand. But if you would please exit sanctuary, amen, to have that conversation in the vestibule, our intercessors will be greatly appreciative of your courtesy. This Friday is our women's potluck. Amen. Right here in Chandler Fellowship. Chandler Westbrooks Fellowship Hall. Amen. Y'all come on out this Friday at 6 o'clock with the women. All the women are invited. Food, fun, fellowship. Amen. We know that when you all come together, have a good time. Amen. So please, ma'am, no sirs. The sirs are going to be making sure that the grounds, the campus is taken care of. So we'll be out there with our flashlights in case anything happens. We call the police. Amen. So y'all don't worry about security. We will have y'all covered so y'all can let your hair down and have a good time in the basement. And don't forget this Sunday coming is our 8th year usher's anniversary. Our speaker's going to be Elder Earlene Teller. All of the festivities will begin at 11. Amen. And please get her on time because we want to make sure that Elder Teller has a full crowd. Amen. And she blesses us. If y'all show up on regular time, y'all might miss out on the word. So come on in, 11 o'clock. Let's support our ushers. We have volunteer ushers. Amen. That's going to allow our ushers to sit down. We want our ushers to come to the front and sit where we can see them, acknowledge them, and honor them. Amen. And trust us rookies to handle the door. Amen. Amen. So wear your good shoes. Amen. So you can chase some kids down. Amen. So we thank God for our ushers, and we want to celebrate them. Don't forget, last weekend of the month will be our King of the Grill, starting off that Saturday morning. Amen. The men will be here smoking it up, getting some ribs ready to, there I go again. Amen. Getting the ribs ready to be tested. We'll anoint our King of 2021. Amen. That will be Saturday, October 30th. Then we will have rib dinners for sale immediately following our King of the Grill. All funding will go towards our men's ministry. And then later on in the afternoon, we will have our trunk or treat with our children. So please, ma'am, please, sir, decorate your trunks. Bring the children and allow them to come enjoy the festivities that will be here and the food and the candy. We know they're going to want the candy, so make sure. And thank you to those who are continuing to bring in candy. We ain't never got enough, so if you want to bring some more, we need as much candy as we can because they like to make sure. And listen, if we have any extra, I know how the youth ministry get in. They're going to give it to them the Sunday morning. So just bring as much candy as you can. Let's make sure everybody gets a treat bag. And then the following Sunday will be our Youth Sunday. Amen. We ask everybody to dress relaxed. Amen. Wear your relaxed fit. We're going to have a good time as our youth show us what they've been working on. So we're excited, and we want them to know they are part of us. Amen. So we're going to let them do them. So just stay prayed up for that weekend because our youth, sometimes they forget where they're at, but they have a good time. Amen. So let's make sure we're here to support them. Don't forget, y'all, we're still in need for items of our Blessing on the Block winter drive, which we'll do it the first Saturday in November. We're trying to put 100 bags together, but we need your help. Look on that list, see if there is anything that y'all can, yes, blankets, socks, toboggans, gloves, toothbrush, toothpaste, pack of wipes, deodorant. Food items can be donated like water, chips, Gatorade, fruit snacks, breakfast bars, and crackers. We like to go down and bless those who are less fortunate. I'm telling you, they are grateful when we do. Amen. And it don't take long either. Amen. Because the need is great. We know we can't feed everybody, but we want to do our part to show that we care. So we're asking if you can, ma'am, if you can, sir, please find some things on that list and donate so we can be a blessing to those that are less fortunate. And don't forget, spread this around, y'all, especially our young people. We need y'all to get God's will in the social media stratosphere. So we need y'all to go and like our stuff and share it and pass it around. Amen. We got some of our seasoned saints that share more stuff than our young folk. And y'all on there at least 23 hours out of the day. So please, ma'am, please, sir, you lay by your phone. If that notification go off, you just woke up. So let's make sure we spreading it around, letting everyone know God's will is here. We want to be visible on our social media. Amen. Hearts and minds clear. Amen. Come on, let's stand. It's good to see y'all. God bless you. We pray that the word blessed your heart, just strengthen your faith.
And I left one out. Because Hebrews 11 and 6 said, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So let's exercise our faith. And don't forget, keep all of our brothers and sisters lifted in prayer. Those who are, we have a few more praise reports. Conte, Ananias has been released. Thank God. Pastor O's out of the hospital. She's back at the nursing home. So God is yet healing. But keep the Yates family and Brother Alex and Jeremiah and everybody lifted in your prayers. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Thank you, oh God, once again for what our eyes have seen, what our ears have heard, what our hearts have felt. God, we pray that this word strengthens our heart. We'll believe what you say, God. We don't need more evidence, God. You've been correct for thousands and thousands of years. So, God, we thank you for staying consistent with us, oh God, for faithfully loving us and help aiding us in our spiritual development. God, we need you now more than ever. And we know that you said in your word, you'll never leave us nor forsake us. So you're right there by our side. Strengthen us, oh God, as we move in and out of the world, that we'll be light in the dark world, that we'll be encouragement and hope for those who are at the point and want to give up. Strengthen us, God, and allow us to minister to them as they have need. Sometimes it's verbal, sometimes it's just a touch, sometimes it's just our presence. So help us, God, to have discernment, that we'll know what to do and when to do it. We thank you for this time. We thank you for this opportunity. Bless our entire church family, those in person, as well as our virtual family. Continue to keep us as we depart from this place, but never your presence. Lord, we're in dire need of your traveling grace to help us to make it safely to our homes, to find them the same way we left them. We love you. We thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you, family. Love y'all. See y'all on Friday.